So, hello everybody. I'm very happy to see that you are there are many of you interested in listening about and reflecting on robustly beneficial algorithms. I'm going to argue that it's very important and that it's also very difficult, so we have to do it well. Just to give an idea of the scale of the problem, I'm going to talk about one algorithm, which is arguably today's most influential algorithm. And this algorithm is the YouTube algorithm. So here are a few figures to give you an idea of the scale of the problem. Today on YouTube, there are 1 billion hours of watch time per day. For 2 billion users, this is an average of half an hour for 2 billion users. 2 billion users, this is huge. There are more views on YouTube than searches on Google. So it's really, really big. And the thing is that 70% of the views on YouTube are results of the recommendation systems. Like, more often than not, people have information that gets chosen for them rather than people searching for information. And given this scale, there are ethical dilemmas that come with it. As Spider-Man's uncle once said, with great power comes great responsibility. And arguably, like, you have a huge responsibility. So just to give you an example of the kind of dilemmas I'm talking about, let's imagine someone searching for, I don't know, like Donald Trump. This happens probably a lot on YouTube. And YouTube has to reply to this. It has to make recommendations. And I'm pretty sure that whatever the first recommendation is, there's probably going to be roughly half of the US population that will find this outrageous that this was the first video to be recommended. And of course, I'm taking here this example of Donald Trump, but I could have taken many other examples whenever someone is searching for vaccination or climate change or how to commit suicide. There's some ethical dilemma about what video should be recommended at that point. Now, most recommendations will not be a matter of life and death, though they can be if it's about vaccination or about suicide. But the thing is that such recommendations are small nudges, and there are billions of small nudges every day. Days after days, weeks after weeks, months after months. And psychology shows like that our human brains are actually very vulnerable. We have a lot of so-called cognitive biases. If you've never heard of this, there's excellent books about this. For instance, the book by Nobel Prize winner Daniel Kahneman. And this means that repeated exposure in particular can have a strong effect on what people eventually believe. This is what, when Yuval Noah Harari came to EPFL, this is what he talks about the most. Basically, his speech was about the fact that humans are hackable, and we tend not to design systems that take this into account. Humans are hackable, and in a sense, they are being hacked every day by these recommender systems that just push them to some kinds of videos rather than others. Now, I could go on and on to discuss all the subtleties of the YouTube algorithm, and it's quite fascinating. But just to be brief, let me just insist on this quote by Harari that he said when he came to EPFL. Well, he said that those who control the flow of data and information in the world control the future, not only of mankind, but also perhaps of life itself. And clearly information is critical. If you think about climate change, for instance, a lot of the problems of climate change is about imposing regulations, which demand some pressure, which demands that the people is more concerned by this issue, which in the end is an information problem. So the control of the flow of information is really, really critical. Information is really power. And if you ask yourself, who today is controlling the flow of information in the world? Is it some president of the United States? Well, actually, the one entity that does it probably a lot more, vastly more than any other entities today, is the YouTube algorithm. Maybe also the Google search algorithm, other algorithms, but in particular, the YouTube algorithm is really controlling the flow of data more than any other entity. So This led us, so Mehdi and I, in this book, to put forward the first thesis of the book, which is the fact that it has become already urgent to make sure that our algorithms behave in a robustly beneficial manner. Now, that's the first thesis of the book. There would be a lot more to say about this. But from now on, I want to talk a little more about the second thesis of the book, which is the fact that, unfortunately, it's very hard. Making algorithms robustly beneficial poses a lot of challenges, so social challenges, policy challenges, economic challenges, but also technological challenges. And I'm going to talk about a few of them and to argue that this is extremely relevant to have robustly resilient businesses. The first I want to talk about is side effects. In fact, most of the problems of algorithms have to do with side effects. So let's take an example, and I'm going to keep my favorite example, the YouTube algorithm. In the end, what the YouTube algorithm is designed to do is to entertain us. It wants us to be watching videos. And that doesn't sound that bad. Especially like if someone told me this 10 years ago, I would be like, yeah, that sounds like a good algorithm. So what's wrong with this algorithm? Well, the problem is not the fact that the objective function of the algorithm is evil in a sense. The problem is that as the algorithm maximizes for this measure, it's going to have side effects, especially if it's hugely influential, as is the YouTube algorithm. Now, let me take an analogy. It's essentially the same problem as when different industries maximize for whatever they're maximizing for, say profit. Like, maximizing profit in itself doesn't seem that bad. The problem is that as you do this, you sort of discarding all the potential problems that your company is going to have side effects on. And typically the problems of climate change is a problem of side effects. The companies don't want to pollute, they don't want to exhaust natural resources. It's just a side effects of what they're maximizing for. And the problem is that this side effect is not necessarily sufficiently taken into account in the objective of the different companies or algorithms. Now, you may say, why should I care about side effects? Well, as the algorithms become very influential, the side effects can be huge. And I'm sure you've heard of Cambridge Analytica. Who here has seen the documentary The Great Hack? Yeah, quite a lot. So it's a really nice documentary about eventually, like, if you think about this, it's really about the side effects of having this algorithm, the Facebook algorithm, that tries to connect different people. It doesn't seem that bad at first, but by doing so, it creates vulnerabilities that can be exploited by different people. And so the large-scale deployment of this algorithm eventually led to side effects. And these side effects were harmful for society, and eventually they were also harmful for Facebook. And they were also harmful for Cambridge Analytica, because eventually Cambridge Analytica went bankrupt. So it's really critical as you're deploying these algorithms to think about the potential side effects that they're going to have. Unfortunately, it's not always easy. So for instance, one thing that has been recommended a lot to the designers of recommender systems is to add diversity to the recommendation of the algorithms. But this result by this research in 2018 showed that actually so I'm very simplifying what's really going on here, but essentially by exposing people to opposing views, so by increasing diversity, it turned out that they measured that it increased political polarization. Which means that this idea of adding a diversity, which sounded beneficial, was actually not robustly beneficial. And the reason why it was not robustly beneficial is because in the model that we had in mind, we did not take into account the fact that the human brain works the way it does, and it has different kinds of vulnerabilities known as cognitive biases. So if you want to be robustly beneficial, you have to take into account all of these factors, which is extremely hard. And so you need to take the time to think about the potential side effects and unforeseen side effects that the algorithm may have, especially when it's deployed at large scales. Now I'm going to talk about a second kind of problem that can arise when you're doing these large scale algorithms, especially if you're doing machine learning, which is the problem of robustness to attacks. There's going to be other talks on this topic. But just to give you a sense of why this is crucial for business, well, this is something that came out last year, so 2019. They found out that there were some videos on YouTube that were not successfully moderated by the algorithm. And these were pedophile videos. And advertisers found out that some of their ads were broadcast before the pedophile videos. That's not cool. In fact, they also saw that the YouTube algorithm was sometimes recommending these pedophile videos. So what's going on here? Is it that YouTube wants the videos to be there? Of course not. This is very bad for YouTube as well. The problem is that detecting these pedophile videos is a very hard problem. Now, I'm sure that YouTube has designed the most sophisticated machine learning algorithms to do so. And like, I'm willing to bet that the algorithm is right 99.99% of the time. The trouble is that the YouTube algorithm is deployed in a very complex environment with potential malicious users. And if some malicious user wants to upload some pedophile video, if he knows that the moderation algorithm is only valid 99.99% of the time, the malicious user can only upload 10,000 videos or 100,000 videos to be sure that many of them will go through the filter. In fact, it's even worse than this because he can exploit the vulnerabilities of the algorithm by doing so-called adversarial attacks. So this is a big business problem for YouTube right now. Just to give you another example, I'm sure you heard of T-Tweets, a Twitter bot that was launched by Microsoft. And the problem of T-Tweets is that it learned from the data from other users on Twitter. And if you've ever been on Twitter, well, you might have realized that there are some people who are not very nice. And it turns out that T-Tweets learned from a lot of trolls, and eventually she became a horrible person or horrible bot, like racist, sexist. She wanted to kill humanity and so on. Now, what went wrong here? Well, the problem is that T-Tweets learn from data, as do all machine learning algorithms. But the data can be corrupted. So the question, one question that you should ask for any machine learning algorithm is that it's going to rely heavily on data, but do you trust 100% of these data? Probably not. Like, if the data set is huge, it's going to be hard to trust all of these data. It's going to be even harder if the data come from users. Not necessarily because users are malicious, though they probably will be malicious users if the algorithm is deployed at very large scales. But so also sometimes the users don't do what we expect them to do, and they just put wrong inputs. In fact, the problem may even come from other algorithms. So for instance, I strongly recommend this video, which is very funny, but also very depressing, because it shows that Excel is doing this automatic transformation of the inputs. And this has caused some companies to lose hundreds of thousands of dollars or even billions. Was it millions or billions? I don't remember. But a lot of money. Why? Because as users put in the data, Excel automatically translated into, like for instance, E1, E9 was interpreted as 1 billion. And this creates an input that's not what you would expect. And the problem is that most algorithms, well, at least the vanilla algorithms that are used in machine learning, they are not robust to this kind of flawed data. And so they may seem to be working for a long time, but then all of a sudden something goes wrong just because one of the inputs of the new inputs of the algorithm gets flipped by some other algorithm or by some user. So you need to be resilient to this. And I guess the question you should ask is, should you trust an algorithm that was trained on 99% valid data? Is it sufficient that the data was valid at 99%? And actually, it's not that clear. It depends on the learning algorithm, and most learning algorithms will not be, at least the vanilla ones, will not be robust to this. Now, there are lots of results, recent results about this, how to do this in a robust manner. And actually, Mehdi has some papers about this. If you want to know more, well, you should get him afterwards. Now, the last thing I want to talk about is the problem of trust in algorithms that you have not designed yourself. And this is a big problem. You design algorithms to be used by users. And you also want these users or the potential customers to trust the algorithm you have. And it's particularly difficult if there are ethical concerns about the algorithm. So for instance, if I take the YouTube algorithm, should I trust the YouTube algorithm? Should I trust the ethical values that were plugged into this algorithm? It's very hard. Like what is done today is that essentially is going to be more or less some vague desires by the programmers, like how much they care about ethics, but also what they believe about ethics that's going to be plugged into these algorithms. And so one idea that was proposed to go beyond this is based on so-called social choice. The idea is that the ethical values of the algorithms will not come from the designers of the algorithms, but from the users themselves. Now, this was nicely introduced in 2018 papers, which we turned into videos with OpenAtom. About the self-driving trolley dilemma. So you probably have heard of this. You have a car that cannot stop. It has to choose between killing here a baby and a grandma. And the question is, what should the car do? What is the ethics that the car should follow? And the idea of a paper by people from Carnegie Mellon and MIT was to learn from the users, to let essentially the users decide. So the way they do this is they collect data from different users about these kind of dilemmas. They ask users, do you prefer to kill, in this case, A or from like A or B, do you prefer A or B? And you give a lot of questions like this. And eventually you do an aggregations of the preferences of the different people, of the different users. So typically, this could be a way for the ethics of YouTube to be designed in a more trustworthy manner. And it actually applies to a large range of different problems. So I really like this paper. It's a very recent paper. It came out a few months ago called We Build AI. It was applied for the problem of food donation. So sometimes there's not enough food to be given. So you have to make some cuts and to decide who's not going to get food. This is a big ethical problem. And to solve it, they essentially ask the opinions of the food donators, of the food receivers, and of the different organizers. And eventually people were happy with the collective decision that came out of this. Again, there would be a lot more to say about this. Feel free to ask more questions now or offline. So my claim here is that we need to design trustworthy algorithm if you want to, for the good of mankind, I'd say. But it's also arguably a business challenge and opportunity. If you manage to create algorithms that people will actually trust, well, it's going to be more valuable. And so I would encourage you to think along these lines. That's what we're defending in the book. And one last thing for those who are, for everyone, I guess, is that this exercise is not just a dull, annoying exercise. I'd say it's a really exciting problem. In fact, it's intellectually extremely stimulating. I hope I've shown you. But it's also really rewarding to be reflecting on what it is that we truly desire in our algorithms. So we have this book that came out, I'm sure of you heard enough of. But if you want to stay in touch, we also recently launched a blog, a wiki, and a podcast mostly about robustly called Robustly Beneficial. If you want to stay in touch, thank you for your attention.
We have time for a question. If anybody has a question, yes.
Just a comment on your car example. It is always widely used. What is never said that usually, and it is never brought up, is that there's a third solution. The car could kill the driver by hitting the next wall. this never came up to the people which want to make the decision. And the other point is, in Germany, it was already decided what has to happen in such a situation. It is just that the algorithm is not allowed to take a decision. So in fact, if somebody has to die, a dice has to throw.
Yeah, so there are lots of legal concerns.
This is a legal solution in Germany, as far as I am informed at the moment.
Yeah, just to go back to the killing the driver, it was actually studied. So it was one of the options in moral machines. And they found out that in Japan, people really wanted to save the worker, but in China, they wanted to save the driver. This is actually a big problem. Like, it raises the question, like, should all autonomous cars be programmed in the same way, or should we make different ethics for different parts of the world? And this can be studied as well. And for instance, it holds a lot for like all sorts of moderations on video contents, for instance, on YouTube.